hi everyone, this is Sonali. Thank you all for carving out some time for attending today's webinar on part two of the VX Learning series, which is all about scaling up. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to introduce our speaker. Please welcome Mr. Gaurav Marya, Chairman, Franchise India Group. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, Sonali, and thank you for hosting this event on behalf of BusinessX. BusinessX is a platform of Franchise India Group, which brings in the entire ecosystem of investors, incubators, startup community, a lot of other businesses, and also a lot of people who want to sell their business. This platform is an exchange for businesses, so which you can list the business and you can also find a buyer. So we always encourage learning because learning is very important for businesses, business owners, entrepreneurs. And this is a very critical time. This learning has to go on. And we have to reinvent ourselves passing through this whole new crisis or new changes which are happening in the businesses. So we divide the entire series into three parts. And every week, every Saturday, 3 o'clock, we talk about one topic. The first cycle of the series last week I did was on investments. So how do you become an investor? Today we talk about scale up and how you scale up the businesses. And next we will talk about how you build value in businesses. And subsequent weeks, we will start getting into a lot of case studies, a lot of examples. Sometimes we'll bring in some other speakers also on the forum, which would talk about their ideas, industry experts and so on and so forth. So today's subject is scale up, so scaling up is very integral for part of your business, because unless and until business don't continue to scale, they would hit fatigue and they would eventually vanish. And this is where we're seeing it much more happening now. Either you need to continue to keep eye on how to continue to scale your business to the next level, and then only you will be able to build some merit value in the businesses. So we have also seen in India, and I just set some perspective here, in the last 15 years, there has been a lot of examples, and a lot of good examples actually, globally in India also, which have actually successfully scaled up. And I should compliment some of the entrepreneurs, and some are extremely young, especially in the startup space. I mean, look at a company like Oyo Rooms, which has started about 8-9 years back, and now it's a global hotel management company. Now this is the power of scaling up, how fast you are able to see. But go into deeper into that. It's just not about raising the capital and deploying the capital in so on. So it has a lot of intermediate logistics which was to be done. Every hotel you acquire, every hotel you turn around, and every hotel you get the right kind of management and so on and so forth. So getting talent on board, getting a lot of operational issues being handled, and a lot of other partnerships and complexity of businesses to handle that and continue to raise capital is not an easy task. I think we should all compliment these entrepreneurs because they have successfully scaled up. But we also have seen, so while there are good examples like Flipkarts and the Zomatos and the Swiggies and the Oyos and the Olas and so many of them, and Lenskart is a retail big scale up story. They've reached to about 1,000-odd stores in no time. So if you really see, retail has been a very, very complex to find locations, to turn around those locations, to get that talent, to get the inventory right, and every store to perform, and to all do this in a very, very short period with people who had no experience in retail. And on the other side, we see a lot of conventional retailers, and in eyewear itself, if you see, there are a lot of conventional retailers who are 40, 50 years of experience, but still would be sub 50 stores, that also running in their own geographical advantage areas, which means that there are companies in Delhi, which are largely in Delhi and North India. There are companies in West Bengal, which are largely in West Bengal and some other smaller parts nearby. So there are, and similarly in South, you will find 2 or 3 brands, but they will never be able to scale this business. And now look at, on the other side, a company like Lenskart, which is not only in operating in India now, they are opening stores in mature markets like Singapore, Malaysia, Dubai, and multiple other locations. They want to have a global footprint. So these are all good examples of scaling up. But we also have, and you can all Google it out and find out, a lot of failures. In the last 4 years, there is about 1,000-odd companies which have closed, which actually scaled at one point in time very aggressively. and they closed. And this can be done for many, many reasons. And we'll talk in today's webinar a little bit on what are the opportunities when you scale up and how you do that, and what are the challenges in the scaling up situation. Recently, one company I was really impressed on their scale up, and now we're hearing a lot of negative news on this company, and almost every food entrepreneur last year was talking about this company. This was Luckin Coffee, started about in 2017. This was historic growth they did. They added 2,000 stores in China in no time and went to US and listed the company. And the valuation shot up, and they were looking like that they would become the next big Starbucks opportunity. And now we are all hearing that all the sales which they were doing was all cooked. It was not right. And companies passing through a trouble, very, very, very large trouble. And their stores are shutting down and things of that nature. So there are something which is very, very good at one point in time with scaling up. And next year you hear the same company is crashing down because there was some inherent problem in the business itself, which was not very sorted. So let's define what is scale, you know, and I've done it in my way. And so I define scale. S stands for strategy. Let's understand strategy a little deeper. So strategy has to be done at both ends. You know, a lot of times we take an opportunist approach. Opportunist would mean short-term cycle strategies. But I personally feel that in scaling up, if you have a long-term, well-drawn strategy, then only it pays off. You also have to see from a timing of this scaling up, because sometimes timing can go absolutely wrong. You can be on the other side of the timing. You need to really see, is it the right timing? If you are in the right flow of economy, you're in the right flow of markets. It's very important because some markets change and some markets are trending and diving. And finally, which is very important in your strategy document, you need to understand that how is the consumer behavior and forecast happening. So next 3 to 5 years, where is the customer moving in for your business? Then only you have to formulate the strategy of scaling. So strategy is very important. Also, a few questions you need to ask yourself. How differentiated you are in terms of when you start scaling up, what differentiation you bring in. You have your core values and purpose been very well defined, and who's your core customer. And if the core customer is not very clear in the markets you want to scale up, then you need to go deeper into the understanding of that. And so that's what S stands for. Now let's understand what C stands for. C stands for culture, competitive advantage, and core competence. Now this is very important. I have seen when people do scaling up in businesses and they go to multiple markets, they acquire new talent. And this happens most of the times when you do the acquisitions. In M&A, this is the biggest problem. M&A is just a function of acquiring a company, but companies don't integrate them, because integration of two companies doesn't work because of the cultures are very different. So how do you really integrate cultures in your scaling up, you know? And that's very important. And I've run my own business. I found this was a big problem. When we scaled at one point in time, our businesses, we find that we were not able to carry the same culture around it, because just scaling up is in so much of a rush that the talent you acquire or the teams you acquire doesn't sink into the broader culture of that. So rather, it can have sometimes a threat that it can disturb your earlier culture itself, because you will come confused as an organization. The second is do you have a competitive advantage on moving into scaling up, and your core competence should not deviate. So unless and until these three C's are very clearly being demarcated, then only you should match. Rather, I call it a C fit. If this fit doesn't move in, you don't go further. So from a strategy viewpoint, think a long-term strategy, talk about the timing, talk about markets, talk about economy, and then go to C and talk about culture, competitive advantage, and your core competence in what you have. Now, next is A. A stands for actionable plan and accountability. So whatever strategy you formulate in terms of your scale, unless and until you have a very strong, actionable and measurable plan, it would not work. And second, it has to also have a strong accountability. And accountability comes from process owners. You need to set process owners in that system, and they would have to work on a very strong accountability on their processes. Fourth, which is extremely important, and I'll give you so many examples. Some great companies have failed in scaling up because there was one time the liquidity dried. So the fourth point, L, stands for liquidity. And this is very funny. You know, scalability is a continuous process, and more you become bigger, more your capital requirement and your liquidity requirement would be much, much higher. You're much more exposed to a lot of external threats At that time, you need to fuel it. Now, you have to have a see that you don't get an interval. You don't get an interval to stop. It's like a flying a plane, and you have to refuel yourself while you're flying. And there is a good quote which says that fuel in the tank is always limited, but gravity is forever. So which means that whatever, if you fuel it up, you pull the tank, but it will still be limited, but gravity is forever. It will always try to pull you down, right? So this is a very important aspect of scalability. I know a lot of companies which scaled, acquired businesses, did a lot of acquisition, and they were not able to sustain those businesses just because they're at a certain time where they thought that their cash flows would start taking care, your internal accruals would start handling the situation, their liquidity started drying. And that is a big problem, even the greatest of the enterprises. And we've seen this in many, many, many companies recently, particularly last 4 or 5 years of economy, has shown us of great organizations, but not able to go further because they, at a certain level, they stopped where they put it. And most of the monies they spend in their scaling up actually gets wasted because they were not able to arrange the further liquidity. So that becomes a big issue. And how do you really create your cycles of filling the tank, right? So, and that has to bring an extreme amount of predictability and timing. Like, for example, say if this last quarter, if companies were thinking that this quarter they would raise money and this quarter nobody is raising money, right? And if you are so tight in your liquidity, and you will hear this news in next one quarter or next to next quarter, you will see a lot of companies shutting down. And it's not that they were bad companies, but they would not be able to sustain this period because their liquidity was already very, very, very low. And this forecast is now changed for the world. You know, every company was having a run for 6 months, or big companies, multinationals would have run outside liquidity about a year or a year and a half or sometimes 2 years. But now this all has to change because this has given a big shock to the world, and they have to understand that they need to have bigger liquidity reserves. Because any adversity happen like this, where you have no incomes or zero incomes or less incomes for 4, 5, 6 months consistently, even the best of the organizations would find a big problem unless and until they have ability to tank it up back. So this would also create a big problem for, especially for startups. And I see startups are in a big, big problem, and they would not be able to find liquidity unless and until they are really disruptive and they are very strongly invested, or their current investors step up and improve their position in the current position in the company. And the finally, E stands for execution. And execution has to be seamless. It has to be having a consistent experience and need to make an impact. So unless and until these three things really come in your execution, it would also not do that. So just to summarize what scale to me stands for, it stands for strategy, it stands for culture, competitive advantage, and core competence. It stands for actionable plan and accountability. It stands for liquidity, and it stands for execution, which is seamless and effective. So the next thing, which is very important, the three challenges when you scale up your business or your enterprise, the three challenges which you would face, and three areas which you probably have to focus more on. And this is one of the big areas, and I have a lot of examples. I used to work with a company very closely as a consultant, and the entrepreneurs were very ambitious, extremely ambitious, and he built a global enterprise. And the biggest problem I saw in his company was people. His people were not aligned with his mindset, and this alignment never comes because he was disconnected. You know, he was an old school entrepreneur who didn't see. He saw himself in a different level, and the people and were commoditizing the system, right? So I should be using that word, but so he was not able to align that, and which I see very differently to these new young entrepreneurs. They really believe in their teams. Their core teams work like them. And they speak the same language. So if you go to a company like a Swiggy, or you go to any company or Ritesh Agarwal of Oyo, if you see the teams around them, are really aligned with them, you know. So they are no different. They don't see that Ritesh alone is making a lot of value for himself, but they see themselves also making value. So unless and until you get your A team be part of your big growth story, it would never happen. So the first difficulty in conventional businesses to scale, I think, is their people management. So first P, the three P's I will talk about, the first P is essentially people. So unless and until you get your core team aligned on your scalability, and they also have a collective goals and collective achievements to be done, you will never be able to find a scalability in your business model. And once they are aligned with your goals and your ideas and so on and so forth, then you will be see that they would bring in equal or more performance for the business. So first P stands for people. The second thing is processes, you know. So scaling up is actually a multiplier effect, and your ability to fix a lot of things at different markets, different spaces becomes even more challenging. So unless and until you have a deep down process, and this is where I think all these multinationals, if you see, are able to do that. So they, because they are very process driven, they are able to achieve same kind of results or sometimes better results in all markets because they are very process led. So sometimes a lot of companies, entrepreneurs fail to scale because they have a very little processes in the system, and they also don't have a predictability of those processes. So they don't know the cycles of these processes, how it should be run, and so on and so forth. And also ownership of each process. So they divide micro processes in the system, and each process has an owner, and this is very measurable. Then only this scalability would happen. Performance is a third P. Performance management system is very, very important, has to be instituted in the system. So how do you institute a performance management system? And performance management is further divided into, say, multiple parts. One starts from planning, and planning, it goes to monitoring. Monitoring, it goes to developing. Developing, it goes to rating, and rating goes to rewarding. So unless and until you put this whole performance management of the team and your people and give them from a planning, how much time, effort, structure, and who are the key planners, then it goes to monitoring. Monitoring team is very, very strong. You have to have a lot of data which is diagnosed and given some kind of a predictability structure. Then a lot of development, which should happen, continue to scale up. And then you rate them, and then you go to and reward them. Unless until this cycle is automated within the system, you will not be able to scale to that level. And a lot of times this is very dependent on entrepreneur. I think entrepreneur should stick, when you are scaling up, into largely on two parts. One, obviously, when you scale up, there are a lot of troubleshooting. So your entrepreneur's time, effort, energy should go into, it would anyway go in because this is an urgent issue. But important would be keeping the eye on the strategy. But if the entrepreneur himself is left on to handle the performance and management and monitoring, it just takes all his time. And it's not something which the entrepreneur should do, or the top management should do. So this is where three P's would come. It's people, it's processes, and it is performance management. These three things are very, very important for any kind of scale up. Now let's go on scaling up strategies, you know, how you should really scale up. So there are a lot of internal strategies which one can do, you know, and how you can do that. Other business or even e-commerce, you need to see what level of performance you are there in that asset, right? So you need to have a very clear, measurable optimum performance levels and a peak performance levels. So unless and until you start shifting your internal targets to first to reach to optimum and then to peak. So a lot of people don't have maximized their each asset. So every single asset of investment which you've done in your enterprise, you need to see how that can be maximized. It should be from a large structure. So if you have, say, warehouse, unless and until you know you have absolutely maximized and optimized your spaces, you have some assets is not, unless and until you sweat out completely your assets and get them to a peak performance, it doesn't work. It doesn't give you that kind of anything. It's a waste of energy and waste of infrastructure. So that's very important for you to really put some internal focus on that. There is another big science going on, is what I call organizational branching, which means that sometimes change is very important in continue to bring in your scale up, and you cannot sometimes bring the entire change in the entire organization. So you create smaller branches, and smaller branches can quickly adapt to the new change, and then it can flow within the organization. So how do you create those changes in the structure? M&A is also a very strong strategy, and I would strongly recommend at this stage, this is a great time for people to put up a long-term M&A strategy, because next year, this might not be this year, But next year early to next 3 years, I think there is a good M&A market, strong assets which would stabilize, which would still be there, but would be available for a good value. So I would say better companies. A lot of people say that this time you will get a lot of distressed assets. I think let's forget about distressed assets. That's not so exciting a strategy, but there are good assets which would be also open in the market. And that can be a very good scale-up strategy to look at M&A opportunities available. Then you also have a what I call affiliation strategy, which means that how you can affiliate with extension of your business and extension of that. One of the things our company does is licensing and franchising can be a huge scale-up opportunity. Franchising and licensing, and I'll explain both of them. Licensing is unlocking your brand. So if you say have a brand and it is running in a X category and you don't know, you want to only stick to that because that's where your factories and infrastructure works, but you don't do other categories. For example, you're a fashion brand and you're very successful in fashion and you do women fashion, but you don't do handbags. But this can be extended to handbags. There would be somebody who's great in manufacturing handbags but doesn't lack a brand. So it can be extended. Like we have a dear friend who runs a company called Damilano. Damilano is a top-class luxury bag company. Now, Damilano can be an eyewear company. It can be also fashion wear company. It can be also go with men belts, wallets, and a lot of other things which he's already doing, I think so. But it can be also shoes. So licensing is all about how do you unlock the brand and take it to the category which you're currently not doing. It's a globally very, very large industry. And I see in India, for scaling up, you can also look at licensing. You can also look at franchising. Franchising is obviously a new channel. And any kind of channel you can look at for expansion of your brand and taking it to the next level. You can also look at a lot of cross alliances, partnerships, shop in shops, many other omni-channel strategies can come in. Technology itself is a very big platform now because a lot of scaling up for companies and brands and products have happened through technology and reaching out to more customers. Another thing which business owners should not keep in mind these days is markets. You know, markets, you should not be having phobia of a particular market which you want to really stick in. You should really think through where you can go. I just finished this week calls with a lot of companies out of Brazil, which were never in our radar. And they all are looking at markets like India. You know, and this is surprising. And when I look at it, it is a great idea because Brazil is very similar to Indian market from a consumer, from a, their buying capacity viewpoint, their behavior, structure, everything very, very similar. While it is a very far off country, not so much people know about each other country and so on and so forth. But you will see in next couple of years, Brazil would become a very strong trade partner to India. And that's the ability I see in whenever you start looking at. Don't conserve your mind in terms of this is the only market you need to have. There are many more markets. So we were invited by a large education company which wants to enter into Vietnam. They saw Vietnam economy is one of the boom economies and they are looking to scale up their education business in Vietnam. So there are a lot of people who are looking for very, you know, strong analysis. And this all comes from if you are having a lot of business intelligence. And business intelligence will tell you how you can scale up and which markets you should scale up. And then there are a lot of external factors. And these days, this cannot be ignored. And now with the pandemic happening, I think external factors have to be looked at. So we should look at all global economic factors. This is the first starting point. Because if you don't see the global economic factors today, we like it or you don't like it. A lot of people say India has always been isolated economy and we always have been better than the world. Actually, answer is no. This is all a wrong perception. We are also dependent on a lot of foreign investment. We are also dependent on foreign markets. We have also dependent on export-import economy. Everything, we are dependent on the world. So if world economic factors are changing, it would certainly impact our markets also. There is another challenge which I saw the big risk in scaling up is always these last 10 years I found is disruptive innovation. You know, there's somebody there is creating a disruptive innovation which can change your business in one single day. You know, so that is something which you need to forecast and continue to see what is going on in the world. You cannot wait for it. You know, so everybody knew when they were listening in early 2000 that Amazon is doing a lot of delivery to homes in the US. Nobody thought that this disruption one day would come to India also. And these disruptions are happening. Everybody saw when Tesla started their electric cars and so on and so forth. And they didn't thought that in 3 years itself, this disruption would come to your market also. So there are a lot of key disruptions happening globally. And these disruptions have to be taken in extreme seriousness. And companies have to make themselves ready to be ready to handle this disruption. I've seen a lot of businesses which were very relevant at one point in time is absolutely non-relevant now because of this disruptions being ignored. So you cannot ignore any disruption which is happening. You need to take it extremely seriously and see, understand where the disruption is coming from and what changes are happening on those markets. And these markets sooner or later would hit your market also. Another area which is very strong, which we always look at and we question sometimes, would people do this going forward? Like these days we are talking about COVID going on. Everybody is talking about would people consume this? Would people go to restaurants back? What people would do this and so on and so forth. And this is what we call, there is might be a substitute for your product or a service coming through. So if that is in the line, it can disturb not only your scaling, your business itself. So always keep asking yourself, you know, is there a substitute which is going to be done? Like we started our career in franchising with the print magazine. And 10 years while we started, a lot of people don't know, we started the digital platform first, then the print came in. But print was only there that time. Nobody used to go digital. And we were telling ourselves in the last 15 odd years that sooner or later print has to go. So we were on the parallel, started working on a lot of our digital platforms to be ready very strongly. But I know a lot of other media houses which were totally dependent on print and they never had any strategy of online. They would not be in business going forward. I mean, they would have to shut down. And companies which are smart like BCCL, Bennett Coleman, Times of India, they have a very strong online digital. They already invested for last 15, 20 years, big time investment while they're running still the biggest newspaper in the country. But they are also equally planned on their all the platforms. They're digitally there, they're electronically on the television, and they are also building up another future media platforms which would come in the market. So you need to really see, is there something being created which would substitute your product or a service? If that is going to happen, then you need to start working on that immediately. You need to also work on the price, the cost management. Cost management is also becoming a big disruptor now because of inflation, supply chain disturbance. Now, a lot of companies, because of China and other things, have a big issue going on. I know steel industry was disturbed because Indian steel was not able to match prices with a lot of imports coming in. So this all is disturbing these companies. And these companies were fantastic companies, but they were not able to sustain themselves because the cheaper steel was imported from outside. So these are all issues of the world economies, and there would be somebody producing somewhere much cheaper than what you can produce, and then the whole scalability can be put to question. And then there is there are two types of competition you see. One is the competition you know, and then there is another competition which is invisible, which sometimes come from inside, which means that your internal company itself, there would be somebody who would become your competition. It's invisible. You don't know that your competition. So you need to really see and be planned for that. That's very, very important point of it. The last part of scale is there are scale effects also, because when you scale, there are side effects for this. And side effects, you have to be ready and you need to create a strategy how you would be in better control with that. First, it's control itself. As you scale up, you start loosening your control. You have to have a mechanism that your control remains on the business. So you have to see that how do you not lose control of the business. I've seen a lot of businesses failing down in scale up because they had lost the control. Second is a mismatch or forecast. When we're scaling up, we are very bullish on forecasting our numbers, which sometimes don't match the way we think so. So that also changes a lot of things. We get over leverage. Now, this is a big, big problem. Scaling up on leveraging yourself and continue to take debt in the system is a dangerous idea. I've always advised that scaling up should be done with equity. It's best to do with the promoter equity, but that would not be sufficient. Then you need to raise equity and raise as much equity you want to for scaling up. That's not a problem. But debt is not so much advised unless and until you have a very strong predictable answers available. So which means that your book is already been defined, you have orders already sitting with you, and then if you are raising some debt, this is still fine. And if the debt is, your balance sheet is not is able to handle the cost of capital, then that is advised. Just for having your scalability and doing future acquisition or bridging those acquisition and acquiring more debt into that, it's not that advisable unless suddenly you have a strong predictability of a horizon of next 4 to 5 years of their forecast being there. Also, I've talked about the culture misfit. This can also be a big side effect which can come in. And finally, you can lose control on a lot of critical things. These days, critical things are not only the other things, it's also about data, it's also about your IP. IP also is a big asset. And sometimes in scaling up, you start losing that IP. So the final thing from my side is that scaling up, a sustainable scaling is a way forward to keep long-term shareholder value in mind. You know, so whenever you are scaling up, you need to really see that is the long-term shareholder value would remain intact and continue to grow. And that's where the sustainable scaling of business should happen. So this is the answer on scale up. We will be more than happy to share the notes with all of you which Sonali would be able to share and pass if you share your email ID. Sonali, if you have some few questions for me, then we will be more than happy to take that questions.
Well, thank you so much, sir, for your wonderful insights. Once again, thank you so much. And we already have a few questions lined up with us. So I'll just take up the first question. So the question is, what is the biggest mistake entrepreneurs make according to you, which stops them from scaling up? If you could just name one.
What is the biggest mistake entrepreneurs make according to you, which stops?
It stops them from scaling up.
So people stop scaling up in the risk of losing their control, or they feel that scaling up, you know, the many mind, it's largely a mindset issue, why you would not scale up. And I don't think any business should stay there. Every business should scale up. But how soon and how fast you want to do that, that's one given on the opportunity and resources. And if you have enough opportunity and enough resources available aligned with that, sources and opportunity should have a balance, then you can go and scale up. Most of the time people would choose to do a very slow scale up because they feel that they would be much better in control of the scaling of opportunity. But I also have a other side to the thing. Any company which has really built market leadership would have actually gone beyond the regular logic. So look at a PVR at one point in time and how they scaled to become the India's largest multiplex company. And almost everybody was saying, I remember that time, Ajay Bijli would not be able to do that. He will never be able to turn around this single cinemas. People will still continue to go there. So a lot of adversity would come to you, but his belief and his study was very correct that he was shifting the whole market from single screens to these multiplexes. And that's exactly happened. So sometimes you need to believe on yourself and your own vision and go after that and scale your business, but controllable, sustainable.
So the second question is, how would a first-time entrepreneur start with the thought of scaling up, planning a tech startup without having enough technological knowledge themselves?
Yeah, so as I said, I mean, find a team. You know, unless and until you have your resources in place, scaling up is no question. So I gave you the first part to this entire thing. Unless and until you have those things available with you, you have right people, you have right processes, and you have a right performance measurement. Unless and until this is in place with you, you don't even start talking about scalability. So if you don't have a technology guy, you get a technology guy, get a good CTO, and then start working on that. And that's very important. If your foundation is not laid and just to try to put the scale, it has no meaning to me.
And this answer in itself answers our next question, which was about if you could only give one advice to an entrepreneur struggling during this time, then what would that be?
You know, so everybody is struggling. So one advice is that this time you're not alone. If anybody is struggling, then everybody is struggling. And every single, I don't see any businesses have, you can only measure them as a low impact or a high impact. Even people think healthcare is a low impact or entire thing. They also are suffering because they currently are overpressured. They have other issues going on and their regular patients are not coming. So everybody is at this stage suffering. So when you are in this situation, you need to, one, keep the calm. Second, this all would pass. Second, you need to see and focus on your core businesses. Leave aside other things. You cannot manage all. So keep the eye on your core business and continue to fuel it up. Continue to paddle it hard. And there would be time that you will start company. I feel that smart companies, smart founders, more focused organizations would thrive as this is all over.
Wonderful. So I think we'll just take up the last question now. So the question says, any case studies of clients where you successfully helped with channel development? So the person who's asked the question says that his interest is in home-based cleaning systems of high end. So any
We are essentially a channel development company. The franchise India, which I'm bearing, is actually a channel development business. We work with over 9,000 brands and home cleaning, commercial cleaning, you name it, we have done it, and all global brands. So that's what our business is. So any help you require, you can obviously reach us.
That's great. Thank you so much, sir, once again for a wonderful session. Anything in the end that you would like to...
I'm happy to share. Somebody has written on the chat that you can share your notes. So I will pass it on to Sonali, and she will be more than happy to do that. And next week, we will talk about value. It will be a very interesting session. And how do you find value? So I always say that people know the price and sometimes their investment, what they've done in business, but they don't know the value of their business. And not even 1% of businesses in India know their value. So we'll talk about how do you discover value in your business.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, sir. I think we'll just wrap up the session here.
Thank you very much, Sonali. Thank you very much. Thanks for coordinating this.
Thank you. Thank you to all our attendees for taking part into this session. We really hope you were able to add some value to your lives. And we'll see you in our next session, which is on creating value, as Gaurav sir said. So please join us next Saturday at 3 o'clock.
I've also put my direct email ID. If you have any further questions for me, you can also reach at gm@gauravmaria.com. Happy to answer that. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Once again, to all the attendees, if you need any notes or if you have any further questions or doubts, please feel free to get in touch with me. You can also type down your email IDs in the chat box and we'll make sure that we send the notes to you. Thank you so much, everyone.